morning, everyone. I'm Gerald Bryant.
And I'm Wandy Lawson. Welcome to a special edition of Lawmakers.
For those of you who might not be familiar with Lawmakers, the program is daily coverage of the Georgia General Assembly's proceedings.
And this Saturday session is being held by the legislature in order to offer people who might not normally have the opportunity to see the General Assembly in session the chance to watch representative government in action.
It's being called Family Day by the House and Senate leadership, and Georgia Public Broadcasting will carry the session live until noon today.
Now, the debate calendar for today's sessions are not the typical measures that you would see on Legislative Day 33 calendar. The Senate will be repealing its unnecessary and outdated laws.
And the House plans to repeal several Jim Crow era laws that are still in Georgia's official code.
And this morning we are joined by Dr. Clarissa Myrick Harris of Clark Atlanta University. And you're going to be sharing with us some of your expertise about these Jim Crow era laws. Tell me about how you became interested and started the scholarship that you've done in this area.
Yes, well, I've always had an interest in African American history specifically, and American history in general. And my interest started in graduate school. I conducted research for my dissertation specifically on the Civil Rights Movement. And in order to understand the Civil Rights Movement, you really have to go back to the beginning of the Jim Crow era, which really began as early as the Reconstruction period after the Civil War.
Well, that's very interesting. We're, of course, going to talk more with you later on in the show. Well, as we might have seen a little bit earlier, you saw that the Georgia General Assembly is already in session this morning. The Senate met last night until 9 p.m. and the House until long past that time last night.
And one of the measures that caused those long sessions were similar bills in the House and Senate that would require voters to show photo identification at the polls.
Now, many Democrats, including the Black Caucus, objected to that House version of that legislation, House Bill 244. Lawmakers Jesse Freeman was there last night when many of those representatives staged a walkout after the bill's passage. He joins us now live from the Capitol with the details. Jesse.
And one, the House Bill 244 was originally a bill that would change certain things about elections in the state, including how the Secretary of State's office informs the public about constitutional ballot questions. The substitute of the bill submitted by the House Rules Committee was much different. It contained language that would shorten the list of forms of ID that could be used in order to vote by more than half. Many members of the Black Caucus said that was reminiscent of the days of voting barriers during the Civil Rights era.
Representative Sue Burmeister sponsors HB 244. Here she explains what sort of ID would be required.
It will be a driver's license, a military ID, a government ID.
Current law is much more lenient.
Essentially restricts it from 17 forms of ID that are currently acceptable, takes 12 forms absolutely off the list. The whole reason why this long list was adopted was because Georgia is a voting rights state.
So many House members argue that this bill is an attack on voting rights.
Tomorrow, we're going to be repealing Jim Crow laws, but tonight we seem to be putting them back in.
And if anybody tell me that requiring a license, requiring a picture ID, don't discourage people from participating in the political process. They live in a fantasy world.
Motions to table and adjourn were unsuccessful, and this bill eventually passed. That's when the Black Caucus and other Democrats walked out.
Tomorrow is the day that we're supposed to attack Jim Crow, but tonight Jim Crow showed up in a three-piece suit.
And all members eventually returned to the House floor, but it is yet to be seen how last night's debacle will influence today's debate.
I think it could have an impact on the attitude and on the spirit of bipartisanship and cooperation that we were anticipating coming into Saturday's Family Day session.
Now, the Democrats who walked out did return to the House floor. There were certain bills they wanted to vote on. A similar bill went before the Senate last night, and a similar controversy led to a similar walkout. We'll have more on that coming up. That's it for now. Reporting live, I'm Jesse Freeman for Lawmakers.
Thank you very much, Jesse. Earlier in the evening, as Jesse said, Democrats led by members of the Black Caucus walked out of the Senate chamber after the Senate passed a bill requiring voters to present photo IDs at their polling places. Backers of Senate Bill 84 said the measure would be a safeguard against voter fraud. The bill's sponsor, Senator Cecil Staton.
I believe that the integrity of our elections and the voting process itself is of enormous importance to Georgians. We want to believe that when we go to vote, the principle of one man, one vote is held sacred. We want to make sure that the voting process has integrity at every point and that we protect that which we hold dear.
Now, the bill has provisions for the state to provide free IDs for those who can't afford one, but opponents of the legislation said the bill would disenfranchise elderly African-American voters.
And I'm standing up for them today. Now, you can laugh about this if you want, but I'm telling you, you are stabbing race relations in the heart with this piece of legislation. You are fracturing this Senate with this piece of legislation. I will never forget this because this is personal to me.
On the passage of Senate Bill 84 by substitute, the yeas are 31 and the nays are 22. This bill, having received the requisite constitutional majority, is therefore passed.
This is wrong. We will not go back.
It's clear that they are trying to restrict the participation of the elderly and African Americans and other people who are more vulnerable in this state. And we just think that it's unconscionable. And we expressed our views in the well. And this is not something that we're just going to do today. This is an issue that has cut to the core of what we are about.
This bill is not about disenfranchising voters. It's about making sure that we protect the integrity of the voting process in Georgia. We don't want the things that have happened in other states taking place here. We've gone to early voting. We've made a huge investment in this state in electronic voting. This is the next step in terms of making sure that we're on the forefront of this, that we have integrity so that Georgians know that we're going to protect one man, one vote, and we're going to do everything we can to make sure that we have integrity in the voting process.
Again, the Senate passed Senate Bill 84. Senate Democrats say their battle against that bill is not over.
Well, as you watch the legislature this afternoon, there may be several procedures in the House and Senate that seem a bit confusing. Many old traditions that have carried on through the years and laptop computers sitting on 100-year-old antique desks, just to name a few. David Zelsky joins us live with a look at some of the everyday procedures and traditions of the General Assembly. David.
Well, thanks, Amandi. I spent some time with Secretary of the Senate Frank Eldridge and House Majority Leader Jerry Keane. We discussed a few of these procedures that have become habit for them, but may leave much of the gallery watching from upstairs somewhat confused.
56 senators on one side of the Capitol, 180 representatives on the other.
Call the roll.
Every legislative day begins with the readers.
Title 44 relating to foreclosure generally.
In the House, the procedure is that a bill has to be read three times in the public for it to, in fact, become law. And what you see at the beginning of the session each day is bills being read for the first and second time. And so the caption on the bill, the introduction of the bill that tells briefly what the bill is about, is read by the clerk. And then it's assigned to committee by the speaker, and then it's read the second time. If the bill makes it through committee, makes it through rules, makes it to the floor of the House, the third time they're read is the time they're actually debated on the floor of the House.
What you're seeing is an abbreviated process of what used to be a very lengthy process. Back when Georgia was first chartered, the state did not own a printing press. So consequently, the only bill was the bill that the senator who had introduced it sat down and wrote in longhand, no copy machines. So members of the Senate, in order to know what was in the bill, they had to listen to it being read.
Both the House and Senate each have their own responsibilities and powers.
Chair recognizes Senator 48.
The bill involving the state's budget has to begin in the House.
The budget drives everything. People might be interested to know that all revenue bills start in the House. So the budget starts in the House, and we know we're going to have it first. So we plot the calendar out based on how many days we think it will take to do the budget. And then we fill in the other bills that are coming out. So I'm constantly meeting with committee chairmen, looking at bills that are coming out of their committee, which ones are coming to rules, which ones we think are going to come to the floor, and try to get our calendar set and manage that day-to-day operation on the floor.
You would think that would give the House an advantage in that process, but that is balanced by the power the Senate has to confirm or reject the appointments that the governor has. And we will have literally dozens and dozens of appointments that the governor makes that the Senate has the sole power to approve or disapprove.
Through the years, technology has changed, making organization easier and gives the legislature the ability to expedite the process.
There's not a day that I don't walk onto the floor of the House that I try to consciously reflect about all those who've gone before us. So much in our society today has been changed and a lot of our traditions are gone. But the perspective and the respect for this institution and this building and the people that sort of built it and brought our state government where it is today, a lot of those traditions have held us in good stead. And there are reasons why they haven't been changed. And even though much of the technology has changed the way we do our day-to-day business, for example, we don't need to have someone read us the bill now. We can get it online. We can sit at our desk with a laptop computer, as the citizens of Georgia can, and read the bill themselves. It still doesn't hurt for us to maintain the deliberative nature. Time, sometime, is on our side. If we're guilty of anything at times, it's maybe moving bills faster than they should. And I think part of our forefathers' great wisdom was slowing the process down. But sometime time will reveal things to you that maybe if you'd have rushed a little quicker, you wouldn't have had a chance to look at.
Now, one thing Secretary Eldridge mentioned about technology was how much money it was saving the state having those laptop computers at every desk. He also says printing costs alone have gone down about 50% since 97. Reporting live, I'm David Zelsky for Lawmakers.
Thank you very much, David. I can remember when the printing operation at the House and Senate was much larger. Well, the House and Senate are in session at this hour, and David was talking about procedures, and that's what they go through every day. Normally, there are a number of procedures they go through. Let's listen in for a moment.
House of Representatives, for allowing me the privilege of serving as the chaplain for today. And since today has been designated as Family Day here at the Capitol, I've chosen the subject of marriage to devote my remarks. Someone has said that marriage is like a three-ring circus. There is, first of all, the engagement ring. Second comes the wedding ring. And then lastly comes the suffering. You know, that may be true for some marriages. But the reality is God has created marriage.
That is the pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church. This is a tradition in both the House and the Senate. House members can suggest particular pastors, members of the clergy. We've had rabbis here as well, different faiths, and they are asked to serve as chaplain for the day, which consists of an inspirational talk, which may be as little as 5 minutes or in some cases as long as 15 or 20 minutes, depending on the particular member of the clergy.
That's true. And, of course, bringing a little levity this morning, that pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church with his little bit of levity on marriage there. From there, they usually will have a prayer and then, of course, the Pledge of Allegiance, ceremonial ways that they start the day every morning here in the House.
And now let's check in and see what's going on across the hall in the Georgia State Senate.
HB 268 for Representative Crawford, the 127th, Bloomington, 117th, and
Rockford. Judiciary.
HB 275 for Representative Cole, the 125th, Montford.
They are reading bills and assigning them to committee. The Lieutenant Governor Mark Taylor is the presiding officer in the Georgia Senate. Now, this is all worked out beforehand, so he knows what committees those particular bills are going to, and the clerk there reading them off by title as they're being assigned to committee. Let's listen in for a moment.
HB 294 for Representative Miller, the 106th, Minnesota, the 85th, and others. Bill 2 and action at Title 40 of the CGA.
Judiciary.
HB 306 for Representative Rice, the 51st, and 136, and Burkhardt, the
50th. Finance.
HB 334 by Representative Munford, the 95th, Boston, the 7th, and Marion, the 94th. Bill to meet on action, because Section 1511.18 of the
Judiciary.
HB 353 by Representative Dodson, the 75th, Jameson, the 28th, Barnes, the 78th, and others. Bill to meet on action,
regulated industries.
HB 355 by Representative Cummings, the 16th. Bill to meet on action, Chapter 7A, Title 47 of the SCGA, relating to the Georgia Clause.
Sign the Committee on Retirement.
HB 366 by Representative Murphy, the 23rd, Maxwell, the 24th, Amherst, the 9th, and others. Bill to meet on action, Chapter 12. Title 17 of the SCGA relating to legal defense.
Judiciary.
HB 367, Mr. Rice of the 51st and Parliament of 141st. The Bill to Maximum Chapter 3, Title 4.
And that's how it goes day after day at the Georgia General Assembly. A lot of procedures that have to be followed in order for bills to be assigned to committee. then pass through committee and then either be put on the floor. Sometimes they're voted down, sometimes they're not considered at all. We'll return to more live coverage of the House and Senate a little later in our broadcast. And Wendy?
Well, outdated Jim Crow laws will probably be soon taken off the books here in Georgia. Today, the House is voting to repeal those laws that once enforced segregation here in this state. Lawmakers Chris Knight joins us live from the Capitol with more about those laws. Chris.
Well, and Wendy, from forbidding interracial marriages to ordering business owners to separate their black and white clientele, segregation was once enforced through Jim Crow laws. A majority of states throughout the country enforced these laws from the 1880s into the 1960s. While these laws are now, of course, obsolete, some of the Jim Crow laws still remain on Georgia's books. But today, House members hope to change that.
They're called Jim Crow laws.
Well, basically, Jim Crow laws were statutes or ordinances that were designed to keep blacks and whites separate or segregated.
They're harsh reminders of a time when segregation was a way of life.
Jim Crow actually began to build in the South in the 1890s as there were all these different efforts to really determine precisely how blacks and whites would be separated, particularly in public spaces. But in the South, it got extended to all areas of almost everyday life, so that in the 1890s, there were more and more attempts to not only segregate African Americans on the rails, but also in public spaces. That could be parks.
And some of these laws remain on Georgia's books, including a law that would allow the state to use public taxpayers' money for white students to attend private integrated schools.
These are laws that through Federal Voting Rights Act and other legislation over the years have obviously repealed their effectiveness, in fact made them against the law. And so no one ever really went in and removed them from the code section.
But that's about to change.
We've cleaned the code up now. We've cleaned the Constitution up.
Representative Tyrone Brooks and Representative Mike Cohn are sponsoring legislation that repeals old Jim Crow laws.
But what really impresses me today is that Democratic leadership, Republican leadership have all signed onto these bills, and they have decided that they want to have Family Day to let the people of Georgia come to the Capitol and witness us repealing and burying Jim Crow forever.
Well, I think it's due time.
Historian Andy Ambrose says repealing these laws sends a positive message to Georgians.
You know, it's to me, on one level as a historian, it's not surprising that some of these are still on the books. But I think it is an important gesture, an act to try to rid the Constitution of these last bits of Jim Crow.
But some Democratic legislators say even though the remnants of Jim Crow may soon vanish from the books, the act is all politics.
The Republicans are going to try and make a big deal about repealing Jim Crow laws, but that appears to be just a charade. They really are, and they've shown a pattern throughout this session now that they've gained control of basically all three legislative parts of government, the governor's office and the two chambers, of basically they want to govern in an authoritarian manner.
But House Speaker Glenn Richardson maintains the message to Georgians is loud and clear.
We will tackle tough issues, and whenever something's clearly wrong, we'll stand up against it. And that's it was clearly wrong to have those laws.
And these five laws that legislators are repealing were passed in the late 1950s. The laws were intended to circumvent the 1954 Supreme Court ban on school segregation. Reporting live, I'm Chris Knight for Lawmakers.
Now, Chris, you mentioned, of course, you've been talking about these Jim Crow laws, and we're going to talk about them a little bit more. Where does the what is the origin of that term, Jim Crow?
Well, the name comes from a character on a white minstrel show in the 1850s called Jumping Jim Crow.
All right, thanks so much, Chris. Appreciate that.
Well, the Jim Crow era still has a profound effect on race relations in the South. For a more in-depth look, we turn to our special guest, Dr. Clarissa Myrick-Harris.
Well, welcome. We want to really thank you for being here today, and we wanted to get a little perspective because for some, perhaps the term Jim Crow is one that they're not even really familiar with. Talk to us a little bit about what we mean when we're talking about Jim Crow laws.
Exactly. As we were just told, the origins of that term, Jim Crow, actually comes from a character created by a white minstrel show performer named Daddy Rice in the 1930s. He assumed this character with blackface and all and strutted about the stage in a buffoon-type manner, and that was supposed to depict a black man, a black character. And by the 1850s, it began to stick as a stereotype, and that term, Jim Crow, began to be equated with that stereotype of a negative stereotype of a black man. The origins of Jim Crow law actually dates back even before the 1890s. The precedent for them actually was established with the black codes that were put in place by the southern states right after the Civil War. And those black codes were put on the books essentially to appropriate the labor of African Americans. Since they were no longer enslaved, the South was really, really wondering what to do about the labor shortage. And so the black codes that they put on the books appropriated the labor and essentially said that orphaned African American children could be apprenticed and could be farmed out to perform labor for no money. Also, vagrancy laws were put on the books that essentially allowed the authorities to arrest a black man, black women as well, and they were forced to work on chain gangs or to work on plantations, farmed out, to work in a variety of locations. And also, those laws also prevented African Americans from owning land. During the Civil War and right after, African Americans, a number of African Americans were given land or bought land. And then with the administration of Andrew Johnson, he immediately began to take that land away from African Americans as white landowners came back to the South. And then after that, there were continued efforts to limit the amount of land that African Americans could own, because ownership of land was power. It meant a lot to be a property owner. And so those kinds of black codes were put on the books. But then there was a kind of sparring that occurred between President Andrew Johnson and the radical Republicans in Congress on the federal level. Mm-hmm. They would pass legislation to, for instance, to limit or to counteract the black codes. In 1866, for instance, they passed the first Civil Rights Act, actually. Andrew Johnson then called upon the states to encourage the states in the South specifically to vote against the 14th Amendment. Mm. And Congress again began to attempt to enforce, to enact and enforce legislation that would really curb Andrew Johnson's power and the power of states to put on the books these laws and to resist the 14th Amendment, to resist the Civil Rights Act. And so you had that process going on throughout the Reconstruction era. There were a couple of laws that actually kind of paved the way for the Jim Crow laws. In 1873, for instance, there was the slaughterhouse laws, or slaughterhouse cases. Mm-hmm. And this was a situation in which you had actual slaughterhouses, places that essentially cut and packaged meat in Louisiana. And there was one slaughterhouse that the government had dictated and decided would be the state slaughterhouse. And all of the butchers had to get their meat from there, and all people who wanted to sell meat had to go through them. Other slaughterhouse owners, independent owners, refused to accept that. And so they filed a suit claiming that their 14th Amendment rights had been violated. Well, the federal government stepped in through the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court set a precedent, essentially saying that the state did have rights. They had the right to enforce certain laws or not to enforce certain constitutional laws. Hmm. If there was a need for that on a state level.
So you get into the whole state's rights issue.
Exactly. So that created a precedent in which state rights began to override and really nullify the constitutional rights.
Yeah, let's back up a little bit. There's an interesting dynamic here because, of course, Andrew Johnson was a Southerner. He was from Tennessee. He was chosen as a running mate for Lincoln to balance the ticket and hopefully get some Southern support. Then after the Lincoln assassination, he becomes president. Some think that he was trying to go through with the Lincoln policies, which would have been a little more temperate Reconstruction. But after he was out of office, and you've got the Hayes-Tilden election in the 1870s, where there was a compromise there, some analogies to modern day, where the Electoral College ended up having to be decided. It was a vote. when Hayes was made president, basically that was the end of Reconstruction.
Exactly.
And it was also the end of black legislators in the South. There is a statue on the grounds of the Capitol here commemorating those who were driven out of the legislature, black legislators. So that was the beginning when blacks no longer had a voice in the legislative process for all these Jim Crow laws to take place and, in effect, reinstitute slavery of a form.
Yes, indeed. It certainly was. And you mentioned the expulsion of about 33 black legislators during the Reconstruction era. They were voted in, and in 1868, their fellow legislators essentially kicked them out and said they did not have a right to serve in office. It took 2 years for them to be reinstated. But actually, there were a few black legislators in the government in the state as late as around 1907. I think the actual last state legislator served during that time frame. And then after that, of course, there was disenfranchisement, poll tax laws, literacy laws. The white primary was instituted right before the turn of the 20th century, and the literacy test was instituted with the 1908 state law. And that, of course, limited African Americans' right to be involved in the political process.
Now, looking at some of what we perhaps think of when we think of Jim Crow laws, we're talking about those that would specifically segregate blacks throughout the South to certain facilities in terms of education, in terms of accommodations, in terms of some other areas like that. We want to take a look at some historical footage of some of these, the signs that kind of make us understand and recognize this Jim Crow. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about those laws and how those began to take shape here in the South.
Yes, indeed. Well, as we said, after the Civil War, after Reconstruction, there was this real push to reestablish the Old South. You know, we know that Henry Grady was a proponent, a booster of the New South. But at the core of the New South mentality and structure was a commitment to restoring white supremacy in the South. And so the laws began to actually very swiftly get on the books. And some laws that we look at them today and they sound almost insane.
Tell us about some of those specific to Georgia.
Right. Well, specifically in Georgia, I have a list here. even on the level of mental hospitals, for instance, the Board of Control, it said, shall see the proper and distinct apartments are arranged for patients so that in no cases Negroes and white persons shall be together in mental hospitals. Barbers, no colored barber shall serve as a barber to white women or girls. Burial. The official in charge shall not bury or allow to be buried any colored persons upon ground set apart or used for the burial of whites. Amateur baseball. It shall be unlawful for any amateur white baseball team to play baseball on any vacant lot or baseball diamond within two blocks of a playground devoted to the Negro race. Parks. It shall be unlawful for colored people to frequent any park owned or maintained by the city for the benefit and use of whites. So they go on and on. And then there were also things that were a part of just the protocol of the day, and not necessarily laws on the books. But for instance, black people were not called by Mr. or Miss or Ms. They were referred to as auntie or uncle or girl or boy. If a black man just happened to brush against a white woman by mistake, then he might find himself arrested, not allowed to look into the eyes of a white person. A black person was not supposed to look into the eyes of a white person. So there were all these unspoken and understood ways of moving through the world that were entrenched in the society.
I would mention that we are still waiting at this point for the House and Senate to begin taking up actual legislation. We will be going to the House as soon as they do that, as soon as they start taking up the repeal of some of these Jim Crow laws. But I would also like to add this, even up into the 1950s and the 1960s, for our younger viewers, it was a very different time in America, because I grew up in the era where there were still separate accommodations, where there were still separate schools for blacks and whites, where there were separate parks. In my home state of Kentucky, there were parks for the colored people and parks for the white people, and I can remember the discussions with classmates about going to school for, with black children for the first time in the mid-1950s. It was a very different era.
Yes, it was. And I, too, remember in my elementary school years, those, well, that transitional period of time. And it's important to note that what occurred in Georgia was an interesting situation in terms of the move to attempt to integrate schools and also the resistance to that integration. There were three administrations here in the state of Georgia that were really pivotal in resistance to the desegregation of schools in the state. Of course, the administration of Herman Talmadge, 1948 to 1955, for instance, and he vowed that the schools would not be integrated. And the same was the case with Marvin Griffin. And then more recently, the administration of Ernest Vandiver. Vandiver was an interesting personality. He is the one who established the Sibley Commission. The Sibley Commission was essentially charged with going through the state of Georgia, talking with the citizens of Georgia, and determining what they wanted in terms of school integration or desegregation. And he was charged with talking with both blacks and whites, and sounded very progressive at the time, in the day. But ultimately, the recommendations of Sibley actually put in place these laws that we're repealing, we're hearing repealed today.
Those are kind of interesting, actually, if we look at those. The laws in question that we're talking about today in the House are dealing specifically with public education, primarily the rights of the governor to close schools under certain circumstances, as well as how schools are funded. Talk to us a little bit about some of those and how those impacted desegregation.
Exactly. Well, one in particular, I think is one that's very important to talk about. It's one that provides tuition grants for children who chose not to attend an integrated school. And that is one that came directly out of the Sibley Commission as a recommendation for what should take place to give people an option. And that is one, again, that is still in the books. And at first glance, you say, well, you know, perhaps it provides choices. But ultimately, it was an attempt to continue segregation.
And Governor Vandiver was the one in office when Brown versus Board of Education came down, and these Jim Crow laws about schools were in place at that time. And the rationale that he had when the decision came down was, you know, if we don't change these laws by state law, we'll have to close schools.
Right. And actually, Marvin Griffin was in office the year that... Talmadge was in office the year Brown versus Board of Education decision was made. And then Griffin came in 1955, and Vandiver really did not come in until 1958. But that resistance...
had lasted till that point,
Exactly.
Well, in terms of some of the bills, I know you just were talking about the grants for students.
Right.
That's going to be repealed, apparently, with House Bill 27, the passage of that bill.
Exactly.
Some of the other laws that the legislators are looking to remove today included one that would have encouraged public school teachers to teach in these so-called segregation academies. Tell me a little bit about that incentive. What was the state trying to do at that point, giving these teachers those kinds of financial incentives?
Exactly. Well, during that time, and this was in Vandiver's administration, they began to give, they wanted to give, the recommendation from Sibley was to give schools, local school systems, the option of integrating or maintaining segregated schools. And they also really, honestly, wanted to have the option of school systems actually closing down, public school systems closing down, and then the creation of a network of independent schools. And then, so they wanted to have that option there, also the option for teachers to work in either the public schools or the private schools, and if they chose to transfer to these private schools, they wanted to make sure that they would still be paid at a rate that would allow them to have the way of life that they were used to, a quality of life.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a reason that particular law was put in place. They have to do with the salary, with the pensions.
Right. So House Bill 28 would actually repeal the ability of these teachers who are now teaching in private schools but collecting their public school pensions and continuing to maintain public school benefits.
Right, yes.
Of course, the law code of any state is enormous. I mean, there are volumes and volumes. is that why some of these bills kind of got lost, or some of these laws kind of got lost and remained there all this time without someone else in the past saying we should really repeal these?
Well, that's an excellent question. I think the reason that these laws perhaps were buried for so long was that the state was operating under this, it had been psyched, you might say, to believe that these laws were actually not the result of segregationist mentality, that they were actually just meant to provide options. Again, these laws were put on the books during Governor Vandiver's administration, and they were the result of the Sibley Commission. And again, people who had the opportunity to speak to John Sibley and to voice their opinions believed that this was a fair compromise. And that everyone would therefore be happy. And so they thought of it as progressive legislation rather than legislation that was meant to maintain segregation.
The same argument was made about the changes in the state flag, that it was not a direct result or a reaction to Brown versus Board of Education.
Exactly.
And I remember a very touching speech made by a former legislator, Denmark Gruber, who was actually there at the time, served for many years, came back to testify when the first round of changing the flag came about, and said, you know, I told myself that for years, and then I realized the truth was it was a reaction to Brown versus Board of Education, and that might have indeed swayed some people to vote for the new flag.
Right, exactly. And I think Governor Vandiver's point of view was that according to federal law, the Supreme Court decision, a state simply could not have laws that call for segregated schools on the books. And so he was very crafty in the sense that he was able to circumvent that. He maintained the letter of the law, but of course the spirit of the law was violated.
It's pretty interesting because Georgia, of course, is known for its peaceful desegregation of schools, and in fact compared to Arkansas and some of the other more violent episodes that people had a chance to witness, the historical record that's often lifted up here is that the schools were desegregated very peacefully. In your scholarship on that, how do you evaluate the desegregation here?
Well, again, that's sort of a myth, because in many very real concrete ways, and I grew up in Atlanta and attended schools in Atlanta, and I throughout my elementary school and high school career education, I attended segregated schools. And so in very real concrete ways, Atlanta's school system, and also by extension Georgia's school systems, really were not integrated until much, much later. And actually, you'll find that there are areas of this state where that it still has not occurred. There is really no integration in those systems. And of course, there are exceptions here in the city of Atlanta and in other cities and towns in the state. Mm-hmm. They are operating with integrated schools, and that's wonderful. But there was in the beginning, in the 1960s, when this push was going on, the 50s and the 60s, Georgia was again did things in such a way that they left the schools segregated, and there were test cases right here in Atlanta. I think 10, ultimately 9 students.
The Atlanta 9,
exactly. And then after that, there was the attempt for school busing to achieve integration, but ultimately after the dust cleared, Atlanta school system remained segregated.
It sounds like it's a battle that continues raging even today.
Yes.
Thank you so much, Dr. Myrick Harris. We're going to check back in with you as we proceed towards the House action on the repeal of some of those Jim Crow laws that are still in Georgia's code.
Well, let's check in with the House and Senate now and see what's going on. Let's first go to the House of Representatives. That is House Clerk Robbie Rivers. Let's listen in and see what he is talking about at this moment.
Senator Kamala's 53rd, a bill being entitled Act Title 25, related to firefighter standards, strings by definition, by certain powers and functions of Georgia Firefighter Standard Council.
Public safety.
Senate Bill 312 by Senator Whitehead.
Earlier in the Senate, the House is now undertaking to assign its bills to committee, as is done every day. You saw earlier in the procedural matters that bills have to go through three readings, and in this one, of course, they are being assigned to committee by the Speaker of the House, Glenn Richardson.
And as we saw earlier in the report by David Zelsky, some of this seems rather cumbersome, but is explained as kind of an abbreviation of what went on in early legislatures when everything couldn't be printed out quickly and neatly as they were today. There were no copy machines, there were no computers, so all the bills had to be written out in longhand. You could not make multiple copies, so the clerks and the two bodies actually read the entire bills so the legislators could know what they're voting on. This is kind of a condensed version, modern-day version of that process.
That's pretty interesting. Of course, as you can hear, they're reading the captions for the bill, about a paragraph worth of copy there at the top of each of the bills, which kind of gives a synopsis of each one as well as the title of that particular bill.
Now, I believe we're seeing some families and tourists maybe in there as well today. This is Family Day at the Capitol, and members of the House and Senate were encouraged to bring their families and to ask other people from their district to visit today. And sometimes you'll notice a rather casual atmosphere. I've had visitors before say it doesn't appear that anyone is paying attention. Well, they go through these cumbersome procedures, and basically they become trained to know when to listen and when it's just a matter of procedure that is not something they're going to be voting on immediately. Why don't we take a look now at the Georgia State Senate and see where they are in the daily process.
Definitely a very congenial atmosphere there.
Okay, there's another tradition we talked about earlier, the pastor of the day, the chaplain of the day, and after he or she makes their remarks, then they are greeted by the senators there. See Senator John Wiles in the lower right, Senator Jeff Mullis next to him talking to the pastor there. So just some congeniality going on there. This is also a signal that they are pretty close to actually taking up business of the day, because then they will go through what are called points of personal privilege, in which senators and on the House side, House members can take a couple of minutes to vent on any particular topic, to make announcements, to talk about legislation, and in fact, it is not restricted to legislative matters. Then they might go through local consent calendars, general calendars, before they get on the actual rules calendar of the day.
That's true. Of course, over on the House side, as of this session, they've changed the points of personal privilege to morning orders, as they're calling them now, and restricting the amount of time. Previously, they would allow more time for speaking, but they've grouped it into a more compact system, trying to, I guess, streamline some of the affairs that go on there in the House.
Yeah, at one point in the House, when the Democrats were still in power and the Republicans were using up a lot of time and points of personal privilege, they moved all the points of personal privilege to after the session, and you could go and talk to an empty house as long as you wanted to. That has been since revised, and in the Senate, that procedure has always taken place before they go on the rules calendar.
Well, it looks like we are very close to getting to some of these points here. We have a calendar for both the House and the Senate. And, of course, Gerald, it's always interesting that the Senate, on their rules calendar, they always proceed in an order according to what's printed there. And in the House, they will skip around, and we really don't know exactly which bills they're going to take up.
Add to the fact that there are so many House members as opposed to just 56 senators, it makes for a kind of a chaotic and cumbersome process. And as you see, reporters back in the House gallery, they're all searching around to see where that bill is, and you won't know when it's going to come up. The Senate has for many years set a rules calendar, and they go in order. Of course, and we're talking a lot about procedure and rules today. That's because we're trying to, those of you who don't normally watch the program wouldn't know about some of this stuff. But there are all sorts of ways to table a bill, to move it to the bottom of the calendar, etc. Well, while the majority of bills voted on today will have bipartisan support, that may not be true for every bill. One bill would repeal the state requirement that everyone receiving a driver's license must provide fingerprints. Here, Speaker of the House Pro Tem Mark Burkhalter addresses that and other laws.
Well, certainly the fingerprint requirement on driver's licenses is one we're going to repeal on Saturday. A whole host of other revenue provisions on taxes that are on the books, that are no longer enforced, but are still on the books, and should the Department of Revenue decide to try to enforce them one day, they could. This is a way of taking that authority out from under them.
Well, while some of the tax laws may be innocuous, some of the Democratic leadership believe that the fingerprint requirement is helpful. Representative DeBose Porter discussed the repeal with other Democrats late last night.
There's one other thing they threw on there that nobody knows. Everybody thinks it's about Jim Crow tomorrow, and that's what they publicized. But they snuck in something this morning. They're going to repeal the fingerprint.
Yes.
You know, the one that Mitch Kay and some more radical side of the Republican Party said, they're calling that part of the repeal. They're saying that they're going to repeal that, too. That's been used by and used properly by our state since he was put in. We shouldn't let the fringe of the other party get by saying on Repealer Day, liking that to repealing Jim Crow.
And we may well see if that issue sparks debate on the floor later today. Now let's go back and check in with the House and Senate again, the Georgia House, again meeting in not special session, but there is something special about this, in that in my memory they have not had a Saturday session. Normally the legislature meets Monday through Friday with some recesses in between there. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that it is a citizen legislature, and you have people from all over the state, of course, participating in that. So the lawmakers like to get home for the weekends. Sometimes they'll stop debate a little early on Fridays to allow those in the furthest reaches of the state to get home. So in this case, they worked not only Friday late into the night, but came back for this extraordinary Saturday session. Again, this is being called Family Day at the Capitol. This was proposed by the Republican leadership in the House and Senate as an opportunity for people around the state to be able to come and see their government in action. There are a lot of tour groups here on a regular basis. There are a lot of school groups in particular. There is a museum on the fourth floor of the Capitol. You can go in the House and Senate gallery and watch government in action there. We see a small child there in the well now in the House. So they are still reading kind of special orders of the day. But this was supposed to be an opportunity for people to come from around the state. In fact, there's even going to be a picnic on the grounds later.
Some barbecue, some
chicken. Since it is a very lovely day in Atlanta, I don't know what the crowds are expected to be, but they might be rather sizable. So again, I think we do have quite a few visitors on the floor of the House, which is unusual because normally only members of the House and Senate are allowed on the floor, and in some cases reporters, and in some cases photographers. And if it gets too crowded in there, the sergeant-at-arms, the doorkeepers will be instructed to remove reporters. I think Wendy and I both have probably been removed from the floor of the House and Senate for
not
a time
me.
Or two. Let's take a look at the Georgia Senate now.
My pleasure at this time to present the Senator from 38, who will present our Doctor of the Day, who is a veteran of service to the General Assembly, himself a major, major leader in the Medical Association of Georgia. Senator?
Good morning, Mr. President and colleagues. It is my pleasure to introduce to you our doctor of today. He's been with us for several years now, and it's been my pleasure to have him. And I keep saying, I said today, I wondered when you were coming this year because I had missed you. So he's a friend of ours that you all know, but let me tell you a little bit about him since we do have some new members in the Senate this year. Dr. Rogers is a native Atlantan. He graduated from Emory University School of Medicine and practiced for 35 years in Georgia as a general surgeon. He has practiced at Piedmont Hospital, Crawford Long Hospitals, and St. Joseph's. Dr. Rogers has had a long history of participation in the medical political arena. He served as the Speaker and Vice Speaker of the Medical Association of Georgia's House of Delegates for a total of 13 years. Dr. Rogers also served as the President of the American Medical Association 85-86. Dr. Rogers has recently retired, and he resides here in Atlanta with his wife, Jean. Let us welcome Dr. Rogers today, and of course, as you know, if you need his services, he'll be downstairs in the medical center. Dr. Rogers.
Thank you, Senator. It's a real pleasure for me to be here, and it's a pleasure for the doctors across the state to come here. And we take the opportunity of that service to learn so much about how this body and the House of Representatives, the whole state government, works and runs, how you do our business of the state. And I think today is a wonderful opportunity for the
people. Okay, yet another one of the procedures that we've been talking about, the Doctor of the Day being introduced there in the Senate.
And in fact, this is unusual because the Senate rules this year prohibit speakers other than senators, then they have to suspend the rules in order to let anyone speak. That was announced as an effort to speed up procedures because a lot of times you have a parade of guests through and a lot of people talking, so it's unusual to allow the Doctor of the Day to actually address the Senate.
Well, of course, we've heard a lot from the doctors this year, as the first law that Governor Perdue signed this year was actually the tort reform legislation here in the General Assembly. And, of course, we saw a lot of the members of the Georgia Medical Association each and every day, and they were making their voices known as the state moved to reform the civil justice code to place some caps on those malpractice.
Yeah, and we might mention they have a doctor of the day because the Medical Association of Georgia does staff a medical center every day. And it's kind of a rotating responsibility. There are a lot of people in the Capitol, and so they have the opportunity if they, in fact, we should probably have gone over there because of the cold and flu for the last week. But if you, you know, you got a headache or there's an injury of some sort, there is a nurse and there's a doctor on staff whenever the legislature's in session, and that's the case today.
That's true. And, of course, we are having the special family day here in the General Assembly, but in addition to a lot of the family activities that are going on today, there are a number of groups from all around the state who are here wanting to get their voices heard and allow folks to know where they stand. A march was held earlier this morning by a group of those citizens who wanted to advocate for a living wage. They are also speaking out for an end to predatory lending, as well as protection for Social Security rights and reform of the juvenile justice system, adequate health care. You can see them there marching around the Capitol, and it seems like quite a medley of signs we see there. I saw a stop war sign there right along with a living wage sign. So people are using this opportunity to see the General Assembly and let them know what some of their viewpoints are on a whole variety of issues. We're going to, of course, continue to cover these protests, and we'll have more on that on our Monday edition of Lawmakers at 7 p.m.
Now, issues like the minimum wage, there is a state minimum wage, which is less than the federal minimum wage, and there's also a bill out there that would introduce a training wage for those, I think, 19 and under for probation period, and that has sparked a little bit of controversy. Well, let's go back and see what's happening in the Georgia House and Senate right now, starting with the House.
House Bill 736 be passed. Clerk Representative Smith.
Right now, what is happening is Clerk Robbie Rivers is announcing the status of bills and doing a first and second readers, as they are called, and announcing those bills that have been passed out of committee.
And we see there Speaker Glenn Richardson getting ready, looks like, to gavel something into session there, perhaps just trying to get some of the visitors and some of the legislators to settle down so they can get started.
All members, please take seats and cease conversation. The House will come back to order. We've now completed first and second readers. We're on that segment of the calendar we call third readings, passage of a local calendar. We have a local calendar. After which we have morning orders. Is there objection to voting on the local legislative calendar as a whole by a recorded vote? Chair is none, except for one. What purpose does Representative Scheid rise?
Mr. Speaker, I'd request that since we only have two local calendar votes or bills, and we have friends here from both Bartow and Cherokee, that we vote on them separately, please.
Gentlemen, ask that the House vote on these bills separately. Chair thinks that's a valid request. Chair has no objection. It's so ordered. What purpose does Representative Hembree rise? Is that an inadvertent press of the button by a member of your family? That's fine. I don't just know that people are standing up. Those of you who are wondering, there's a computer system when they press a button on their desk and it pops their name up on a screen down here. I couldn't tell. Okay, we're going to vote on these separately. So, clerk, can you get those where we can vote on one at a time? Which one are we voting on first? 733 from Bartow County. Representative Lewis, anywhere near? Are you ready? Yeah, I just want to make sure you're going to want to vote on this. Bartow County. We're going to vote on the Bartow County.
Of course, generally with the passage of local bills, they're usually grouped together and just a single vote to pass those measures, which of course deal with specific jurisdictions or municipalities. In this case, since it is Friends and Family Day here at the Capitol, and we do have members from these both of these jurisdictions, they did request that these bills be voted on separately. They, of course, are generally not statewide laws. They're laws that will affect just that city or that county. So at this point, they're voting on those separately so that the residents from Cherokee and Bartow counties can see each of their local bills passed separately.
Yeah, as Lundy mentioned, they don't need a statewide vote because they only affect a specific jurisdiction. Occasionally, you will see someone in one of the delegations who is not on board with that particular piece of legislation. They will ask for a full debate in the House. That doesn't happen very often. These are generally housekeeping measures.
That's true. And, of course, as Speaker Richardson pointed out there, they have the computerized system whereby the members of the House, or in the case of the Senate, can let the presiding officer know that they wish to speak, and they do that by pressing a button on their desks, and it lights up, gives the speaker the name of the person who's requesting to speak, and he can then recognize that person.
Have all members...
See the electronic voting board there, and as he's calling for that last bit of voting to go on, and then they will lock the machine, and you will see, of course, the tally come up as per the vote on this particular bill.
You can get printouts of these tallies in the House and Senate. Interestingly enough, there is not the equivalent, neither the House or the Senate, of the congressional record. There is not a printed transcript of everything that goes on. There are daily reports of activities and reports of votes, but not of the actual debate. There's no transcript of the debates, other than, I guess, we probably provide as much of that as anything on our program and archived on our website.
And so that first local bill, of course, they're getting unanimous consent, and now they're going to move on to the other jurisdiction.
To authorize the city of Canton to exercise all redevelopment and other powers on the Constitution of the State of Georgia and the Redevelopment Powers Law. Prior for a referendum, this bill had been for the House Committee on State Planning and Community Affairs. The committee recommends that this...
Again, we have Clerk Robbie Rivers, and let's go over to the State Senate now, where we do have some activity in the well. That is Senator Vincent Fort.
Acquired last evening when this body passed out a bill that turns back the clock to a time that we would all like to forget. We passed a bill that will, in effect, disfranchise...
Briefly, Senator Clark is talking about Senate Bill 84, which would require photo IDs for voters.
It will disfranchise people who have struggled long and hard to gain the vote. That is a family value that I cannot abide by, and I hope that no one can abide by. It was done with a callousness that I have not seen in this body before. And then there was a motion to cut off debate. A motion to stop the free and fair exchange of ideas. I've been reading the Federalist Papers a lot lately. Reading the Federalist Papers and reading the words of Alexander Hamilton and John Jay and those founding fathers of this republic. And what is at the core of what they said is that we need free, fair, open debate. Only through the exchange of ideas can the republic remain strong. Last night was the crowning injury to that concept of free and fair debate. There are those of us who feel as if the Senate last night reached its lowest point. There's some elected officials who say anything we do here at the state capitol never gets back to our districts. But character is about doing the right thing, even when what? Nobody is watching. That's what we teach our young people. Do the right thing, even when no one is watching. But the whole world is watching. I've looked on the internet this morning. The story about what happened last night has gone to London. It has gone to Asia. It has gone all over the country and all over the world. And I just mourn for my state when the thing we are known for is passing the most restrictive requirements for voting since the Jim Crow era. We have replaced, over on the House side this morning, we're going through the effort to do away with Jim Crow laws.
do away with segregation era laws. Well, last night, what we did is we went back to the era of Jim Crow. We're replacing some Jim Crow laws with another Jim Crow law. That's not right. When the history books are written, what we did last night will bring shame on the state that we love. Mr. President, members of the Senate, the struggle continues. We will not let the clock turn back. Sometimes we say the clock is being turned back for rhetorical reasons. But it's not rhetorical. This is substance. The clock's being turned back. But the struggle continues. We will fight until the last. Thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate.
Thank you, Senator.
That was Senator Vincent Ford. He was talking about the vote that was taken last night in the House and Senate. And this was in the Senate. It was a particular bill, and that was Senate Bill 84, which had Republican sponsorship. And it would require photo identification, such as a driver's license, passport, employee ID, etc., for people to vote. Now, the sponsor of the bill said the reason for this was to reestablish more integrity in the voting process and to help prevent voter fraud. In fact, the bill does allow people to get a free identification if they can't afford one. This brought swift reaction, especially from members of the Black Caucus in the House and Senate, who said that this would help disenfranchise especially elderly African Americans who may not have that type of identification, and at the very least, in their opinion, it would discourage people from voting. So they staged a walkout both in the House and Senate after those votes were taken. The House took up a similar measure, and both those bills did pass, and members of the Black Caucus and the Democrats saying we haven't heard the last of that.
That's right. Of course, we are getting ready to go back over to the House, where I believe they're getting ready to undertake some of the business. We have in the well there Representative Jerry Keane, and he's speaking to those Jim Crow bills. Let's listen in.
And tell in greater detail what these bills do, and by removing them, what they will free us from. But lastly, on behalf of the leadership of this House, we want to welcome you here, thank you for being here, and enjoy your state capitol. I yield the well, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Keene. Chair recognizes Representative Reese of the 11th for a morning order. Representative Reese.
Okay, of course, the House Majority Leader, Representative Jerry Keane, there welcoming all of the Family Day participants in as we take a look over at the Senate.
That is Majority Leader Bill Stevens, one of those who proposed today's Family Day.
From Raven Gap to Tybee Light, from Savannah to Macon to Atlanta to Habersham County. If you listen outside real close, you'll hear the strings of the young members of the Chetta family up in Habersham County, and they're going to be playing for us outside. You hear them now as the door opens, and you'll hear them again here in the chamber after this, representing their part of Georgia. And of course, you are here, those of you here in the building, and we're pleased to have you with us today. This is Family Day. It's an idea that we came up with a few weeks ago. One, to just highlight the importance of Georgia and its 8.8 million people and the families that are represented by the members here. The Lieutenant Governor, the President of the Senate, has done a tremendous job describing to you what's going to be happening as we go along, doing kind of a play-by-play or color commentary so that those that are not as familiar with this process will know what's happening. And also I want to take just a moment to offer a special thanks to all the law enforcement people who are guarding everybody from Kevin over here, the governor's lieutenant governor's security person, to those that are the state patrol who are manning the perimeter of this building, and of course more than that, all those law enforcement officers that are working on what the GBI describes this morning as the biggest manhunt in Georgia history. So let's have our thoughts and prayers be with them as we celebrate families here today. We're going to be dealing with several bills that are on the calendar, and they are unique. The bills that we're going to deal with today deal with taking off laws from the books. Normally, we place laws on the books and nothing, and change laws that are already there. But today, we're going to deal with taking some old antiquated laws off the books. As you hear them explain, you'll hear a little bit about Georgia history. One of them has to do with steam engines, and others have to do with other subjects that have long passed. Georgia has a long and rich history that all of us represent here. Our system of government is unique, as reflected in probably the difference between my comments and the comments from the senator from 39. We do differ on the way that we look at life and look at Georgia, but that's okay. As Winston Churchill said, this system of government is probably the worst system of government ever devised by the mind of man, except for all the rest of them. What we do here in this building is what we as Americans do rather than harming or killing each other like they do in other countries. I think of this gold dome, I was thinking about it this morning, coming in as kind of a giant pressure valve. It's where we let the pressure off. It's where we come and discuss ideas, and you're going to hear that this morning. Democracy, by its nature, is very noisy. It's very slow. It's full of checks and balances. It sounds like a thousand pots and pans being clanged together all at once, but it is how we govern ourselves. And as Lieutenant Governor said earlier, we're all here, the 56 senators, representing over 150,000 individual Georgians. And if you look at this body, we look like Georgia. We're black, white, and Hispanic. Some are young, some are old, and somewhere in between. Some were born here and grew up here. Others didn't. For goodness sake, our Rules Committee chairman grew up and is from New Jersey, of all places. We're Democrats and Republicans. We're Christian, we're Jewish. Some of us are from North Georgia. You can tell in my short clipped accent, I'm from the North Georgia mountains. If the senator from the 14th were up here, you'd hear the long, slow drawl of the Flint River Basin area in southwest Georgia. So we're different, but we represent Georgia. We're tall, thin, short, some ergonomically challenged, if you will, dark hair, gray hair, and no hair. But we have two or three things in common. One is we do breathe all the same air. Two, we love our children and our grandchildren, and we're trying to do the best we can to represent them. And probably more than all that, we love this great state of Georgia. So God bless you for being here. Enjoy the history lesson. Enjoy the civics lesson. And join me in just thinking about how blessed we are to live in the greatest nation, in the greatest state, in the greatest nation that this world has ever known. Thank you all for being here this morning. I'm sure I'll be followed by the distinguished minority leader who will be introduced by Lieutenant Governor and perhaps others. But thank you for being here. Enjoy this. And when it's over, we should be done around noon, hopefully. When it's over, there'll be food around different places in the Capitol. I understand that the fire marshal is having a challenge this morning. That's a good thing.
That is Senator Bill Stevens. He is the majority leader in the state Senate, and one of those members of the leadership of the House and Senate who have been referring to this Saturday session as Family Day, since the decision was made to hold Day 31 on a Saturday. Many activities for families and children have been planned, and we have had some of our photographers out there taking pictures of some of the Family Day activities. There you see... that's one of those inflatable slides for the kids on the Capitol grounds. So it was billed as Family Day, and although we saw a protest march earlier, we're seeing members of Georgia's families out there. The unusual sight of family members on the House and Senate floor, and we have a tour group there. Looks like a high school team of some sort there, and there's Senator Bill Hamrick. Chatting with some of his constituents. People taking this opportunity. Normally, you don't see that many people at the Capitol on a weekend, but this is an opportunity for people to bring their children, their families in, and see government in operation.
It's all very, very cute there. And, of course, you see there that some of the families are actually there in the chambers enjoying time with their legislative relatives in some cases. In some cases, they are the constituents of the relatives. There's Representative Benfield and her young son actually having a snack there on the House floor.
It's a fairly unusual sight to see the children of legislators, except on the final day, on sign and die. Generally, people will bring their families up, and it's a more informal atmosphere. And we'll be bringing you more about those family-oriented activities Monday night at 7 p.m. on Lawmakers. Now let's return to our coverage of the General Assembly session in progress. We haven't checked in live in the House for a while.
That's right.
Let's see what's going on in the Georgia House of Representatives.
You see there in the well, Representative Alicia Thomas Morgan. We can listen in and see what she is taking her morning order on.
For those of you that may not know, I'm the youngest member of the legislature and very proud of that honor and hope that more young people will serve in this body. But there are a few comments that were made to me and I want to come and clear my heart. A couple of folks who called me Cynthia McKinney Jr., Mr. Earhart. Some folks who made other comments and asked what I was going to come and grandstand about today, but I wanted to clear the record because thank God for the people in the District 39 who don't consider it grandstanding but consider it a voice for working people. The people who want me to be elected to make sure that everyone knows that not all members of the legislature want to limit your government. Not all members of the legislature want things to be secret. Not all members of this legislature want to take Medicaid from working families. And so it's okay if you call me Cynthia McKinney. I'll live with that. But I would hate to be called one of the congressmen from, I believe it's South Carolina, a U.S. senator. I would hate to have some of the actions of a Strom Thurmond. So if you can call me Cynthia McKinney, that's fine, because she's in Congress and she serves her constituents well. And I believe that I do the same. But I wanted to come and stand and make sure...
Lady's time has expired.
I wanted to make sure that you knew that there are all kinds of voices in your legislature. I encourage you to continue to come down, learn about the process, and I encourage the young people who are here today,
Lady's
if you
time
may hear some
expired.
Comments from your family, negative things, tell your
Representative
parents
Morgan,
that we are equal
your time,
and that we should all love
Representative
each
Morgan,
other.
The chair is going to insist that your time has now expired.
As I close, I will tell you that in the spirit of Martin and in the spirit of Malcolm,
Representative
someone
Morgan,
said to
your
me
time.
Last night, this morning, it's so great that you could come and smile. And I'm here still smiling
Representative
because
Morgan,
I ain't going to let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around.
Of course, there you see Representative Alicia Thomas Morgan staging her own personal protest there from the well. As we mentioned earlier, the morning orders there in the House, they're divided among the number of speakers who have signed up, and each is given a designated amount of time. She was being told that her time expired and continued, of course, to speak there from the well, as she has left the well at this point. We're going to listen back in as Representative Glenn Richardson, the Speaker of the House, continues.
The rules of this House. And when the chair says the time has expired, they wrap it up and do not ignore the chair. It is essential in our form of government that we have an orderly system of presenting our ideas and respecting authority and not defying it. That is why we are a civilized nation. And in this space of the last 24 hours, the chair's patience have been tried. And the chair apologizes for having a temper. But I respect the rules of this House and have served here a long time when things didn't happen the way I wanted them to. And the chair heeded those. At this point, we have several more morning orders. The chair is going to insist that our members comply with House rules. And we'll take up violations of those rules after today. But we will not take it up further today. Representative Holmes is recognized for a 2.5-minute morning order. Representative Holmes.
and those morning orders, of course, continuing there in the House with a bit of admonishment there from Speaker Richardson about the violation of the rules. Another of the rules there in the House is that the applause actually are against the House rules as well.
There's not normally supposed to be cheering. There's not supposed to be applause or certainly boos or anything like that. Last evening, the Speaker also admonished some members of the House who began singing, or some people in the gallery, and the Speaker said that they might be censured at a later point for violating the House rules.
Interesting. Of course, Representative Bob Holmes there now presenting his morning order in the well, being admonished by the Speaker to maintain that 2.5 minute time limit. Let's listen in.
45,000 people just like the Speaker, but those people do not have a voice unless you allow me to speak. We say that the rules are supposed to be adhered to, but what in fact had happened with regard to Senate Bill 37. You had a local rule that was advertised, and then it was made a general bill. In 659, you had people who weren't even part of the jurisdiction that they were trying to deal with, that is Richmond and Augusta, and yet this bill was allowed to come out of the Rules Committee and to be voted on the floor. So who is in fact abiding by the rules? Certainly those particular examples don't bode well for that. We say that we are, in fact, a democracy, and this House is run in a democratic fashion, and we should, in fact, you know, be civil.
That is Representative Bob Holmes, representative from Atlanta. They are also on points of personal privilege in the state Senate. So if we can, let's go over and check who is in the well over there. I believe that Senator Regina Thomas from the Savannah area, who is famous for her hats, among other things. Let's listen in with Senator Thomas for a moment.
And I know that God in His time will take care of everything. So don't be discouraged by all the evil that's going on in the world. We were born to die. We just don't know how we're going to die. But I can say to this body, on this family day, and the minister this morning that talked about children and health care and education, we are not doing enough to help the families of this state. We can do so much more to help our families, to help the children who don't have any health care, to help those who are making minimum wage. We can do so much to help people, and we need to try to do that. Thank you, Mr. President, and I yield the well.
Thank you, Senator. Any other senator wishing to rise on a point of personal privilege?
Senator Regina Thomas from the Savannah area. She represents the 2nd Senatorial District, and the Lieutenant Governor Mark Taylor asking if anyone else would like to take advantage of a point of personal privilege. Again, these are not necessarily legislative in nature. This is part of the procedure, part of the tradition in the House and Senate, that members are allowed to come up and speak on a topic for a limited period of time. And some people might have thought that the Speaker Richardson was harsh, but normally these are rules that are adhered to pretty closely as a courtesy, he making the point that some action might be taken later. Now let's return to the House of Representatives and let's see who's in the well.
From Savannah, Georgia. In our gallery today, we have the Savannah Silver Cheetahs, a youth trike team. Stand. This youth track team has received national attention for their athletic ability. But this year's team is especially well because all the members of this year's team are all honor students at Savannah Public Schools. This great mentoring program started in 1983, and since that time it has assisted 80% of its youth to colleges and universities in this great state. I'm proud to present to you my special family, the Savannah Silver Cheetahs. Thank you.
And of course, Savannah legislator there, Lester Jackson, introducing a track team from his region. Another one of the ceremonial things that are done both in the House and Senate, that is introducing special groups and reading resolutions on their behalf.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Let me just say that I come this morning with a very heavy heart. I'm going to lay down partisan politics, which is very difficult for many of us in this chamber. But all of us at this point are aware of the tragedy that happened in Fulton County yesterday. I have to mention that it struck close to home to me. Roland Barnes, the judge that was killed, was a friend of mine, a friend, a judge, a lawyer in my community for over 20 years. A fine, fine, fine man. And I started thinking, I said, well, what can I say about someone that served the community so unselfishly? I can say what he would probably tell me to say to you, that you might want to realize that life is very finite. You might want to realize we might have partisan differences, we might not like each other ideologically, but you never know when it'll be over. So ladies and gentlemen, I'm not here today to talk about my philosophy. I'm simply here to say, I want you to join me in saying that every life is precious. We want to respect Roland Barnes and others that were killed yesterday in a tragedy. And most importantly, we need to say that the ego in this chamber is not as important as the God that's in us. And if you ever get to the point that you don't realize who you are, you better start being who you is and not who you ain't. Because if you ain't who you is, death might catch you and you'll be what you ain't. God bless you.
Representative Joe Hextall there of East Point calling to mind the fatal shooting of a Fulton County judge yesterday as we turn our attention to the Senate.
Voter access states in the union. And I want the people of Georgia to know it. And I want the people of the United States to know it. Despite that, I want you to have a great day at the Capitol. But we come here to deal with serious matters. And I respectfully request consideration on this important matter. Thank you very much to the citizens of Georgia.
Thank you, Senator Kasim Reed. He was one of those who made a very impassioned speech last night over Senate Bill 84. Let's stay in the Senate for a moment.
The Senate is united on, and one is supporting
Senator John Douglas.
I want to invite you all to see some of our military equipment out on Mitchell Street before you leave today, courtesy of the Georgia Army National Guard. An M109 self-propelled 155-millimeter howitzer parked in the middle of the street out there. It's out there for you to look at, for the young people to climb on, and for the old people to climb on, too, if you want to do that. So please go out there and see that. And
Senator Douglas here talking about some of the military displays that are outside for Family Day, and this was originally designated as Family Day at the Capitol.
Is in spite of all the business that we've taken care of and the important legislation that's passed this General Assembly this year, the most important day of the year for us is coming on Wednesday, ladies and gentlemen, and that's NASCAR Day. NASCAR will be here on Wednesday. If you've never been to NASCAR Day at the Capitol, we have Mitchell Street closed off, and we actually have race cars parked out there from the Atlanta Motor Speedway. And it's a great time to come meet some drivers, come see some actual equipment that's used in NASCAR, and enjoy a day at the Capitol. I have the great privilege of representing the Hampton area in my district in southwest part of Henry County, Atlanta Motor Speedway. And so let me just invite all of you to come back on Wednesday and enjoy the hospitality of the state and NASCAR. Thank you, Mr. President.
We just heard Senator Douglas, who represents the eastern metro Atlanta area, a veteran of military service, the United States Army, and he has done the former member of the House who has been elected to the upper chamber and leading our Veterans and Military Affairs Committee on so many issues. Chair recognizes the Senator of the 18th District now. The Senator Staten represents the North Macon area in Middle Georgia, a long career with Mercer University and a freshman member of this body who we enjoy working with very much. Senator from the 18th is recognized. Point of personal privilege.
Thank you, Mr. President, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate, and all of you who are visiting with us today. You've heard several references already this morning to Senate Bill 84, which was passed by the Georgia Senate yesterday evening. I simply want to make sure that Georgians understand what Senate Bill 84 is all about. Basically, it is this. We're asking that when you come to vote in Georgia, bring a photo ID. It's that simple. Maybe you will not understand that at present in Georgia law, there are 17 forms of ID that you can use, including a power bill, a bank statement. We're simply saying that it's in the best interest of voter integrity in Georgia to make sure that we have integrity in our process and that we stand firm on the principle of one man, one vote in this state. That when you come to vote, bring a photo ID. And we even said in this bill, if you don't have a photo ID, if you can't afford to get a photo ID, you can get a free photo ID at DMVS, the Department of Motor Vehicles. So that's what this bill is about, and we believe it's common sense legislation, but more than that, it's legislation that will guarantee in the state of Georgia that we have a integrity in the voting process. That's Senate Bill 84. When you come to vote, bring a photo ID. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
That was Senator Cecil Staton. Now, he was the senator who introduced Senate Bill 84 and argued on its behalf last night in the Senate. As he was explaining, it would require voters to bring a photo ID to the polling place. That was the source of much contention last night in the Senate. Similar bill in the House. Several speakers this morning on points of personal privilege referencing that particular piece of legislation, and Senator Staton defending his stand.
Well, we are, of course, getting down to the business of the House and Senate as those points of personal privilege are wrapping up. One of the primary points that we've been talking about in terms of what's going on in the House is the repeal of three Jim Crow era laws from the books here in Georgia. And we have with us our special guest, who is Dr. Clarissa Myrick Harris of Clark Atlanta University, an expert in the area of African American and African history. So I'm wondering, as we look at these laws, of course, we've heard Representative Tyrone Brooks, the sponsor of the three repeal bills, telling us that the laws were actually found after a University of Arizona study was able to uncover them. I'm wondering about, from the perspective of those who are in academia, how are some of the techniques that perhaps the Internet has allowed you to use able to be used to uncover laws like this and then lead to their repeal?
Oh, most definitely. Nowadays, states often put all of their pieces of legislation, their state constitutions, their various codes, as well as various bills that are going before the House and Senate, on the Internet, which makes it so much easier to do the kind of research that would be necessary to uncover these kinds of laws that have been hidden over the years. The Jim Crow Study Group out of the University of Arizona is the organization that produced the report that told us essentially that, well, Georgia, you still have these Jim Crow laws on the books, along with seven other southern states, including Mississippi, Alabama, Louisiana, Virginia, West Virginia, so Georgia was not alone.
Let me ask you this. Were Jim Crow laws restricted to the South, or were there other states in the Union that had similar racist legislation?
That's a very important point, because often people think that they were restricted to the 11 former Confederate states, and that's just not true. There were Jim Crow laws in the North, in the Midwest, in the West, on the West Coast, and they were primarily laws that were meant to keep African Americans out of public accommodations. Often they had to do with train accommodations, designating certain passenger cars on trains for blacks and others for whites. So these laws existed throughout the country.
Well, as they began to be repealed, I guess, beginning in the 50s, moving through the 60s, and even later than that, as we see today, one of the mechanisms obviously being legislative, people actually being able to overturn these laws, but also a lot of protests leading to some of these things. We want to take a look at some historical footage of some of these protests that led to the repeal of many Jim Crow laws. But I'm wondering, what role did civil disobedience and some of the other forms of protest play in repealing these Jim Crow laws?
Oh, a very important law. Or important role on repealing the laws, because these protests from the student sit-ins in Greensboro, North Carolina in 1960 to the protests and demonstrations and marches turned the eyes of the world onto the United States and essentially pointed out the absurdity of such laws. And so there was a human cry in this country and elsewhere in the world.
I would point out, too, that while, of course, newspapers were always very powerful, this was kind of the seminal days of television broadcast news, and people could see these images for the first time, some of the stark images that we have seen in the past of police officers turning loose dogs
exactly.
on protesters and powerful fire hoses on them. And did this cause a hue and cry and an awakening among white members of society who may not have been as aware of what was going on?
I think it did that, and I also think it ultimately caused a great deal of embarrassment. And so the hearts of some people may not have been changed, but the realization occurred that in order for this country to be looked upon in a positive light, that some basic changes had to be made.
And so in terms of actually influencing what ultimately happened legally, what form did these protests actually have, or what impact did they have on changing the laws?
Well, let's look, for instance, at the Voting Rights Act, which we just celebrated the anniversary of, the 1965 Voting Rights Act. That piece of legislation, although it was initiated by President John Kennedy, was actually carried out, pushed through by President Lyndon Johnson, and he had an extra push to get that act passed after the incident at the Edmund Pettus Bridge and the Selma to Montgomery March.
And having read some of the history in the past, President Kennedy, while he was revered, was not especially effective in getting some legislation passed. Lyndon Johnson, with his history as a powerful leader in the House and Senate, knew a lot of arms that could be twisted, and being a Southerner as well, could use that influence to get legislation like that passed.
Exactly. And I think he took a number of people by surprise. Many did not think he would be as forceful in terms of trying to overturn Jim Crow laws and enact new laws.
We're going to actually take a look into the House right now as Representative Tyrone Brooks is introducing the first of those Jim Crow laws. That's House Bill 25. Let's listen.
Waiting on you at the Capitol. And I said, well, I will be over to Montgomery, but we have some very important business to take care of in Georgia first. We've been marching from Selma to Montgomery all week, and the march ends today at the Capitol to Montgomery. Dr. Joseph Lowry will be taking us in to meet with Governor Riley this afternoon. Someone asked me as I was coming up the steps this morning, what will the people think of us repealing Jim Crow? And my response was, that's the wrong question. What will the people think if we do not repeal Jim Crow? My colleagues joining me this morning will speak to these bills. We have five measures. And so that I won't have to come back to the well four or five times, Mr. Speaker, I would like to just let you know what the lineup is. We have Representative Cohn, who will follow me, the Majority Leader, Mr. Keene, who will follow Mr. Cohn, the Minority Leader, Mr. Porter, who will follow Mr. Keene, the Chair of the Legislative Black Caucus, Mr. Watson, who will follow Mr. Porter, and one of my deans and my brother from Columbus, former president of the Georgia Association of Black Elected Officials, Chairman Ruse, Chair of the Democratic Caucus, Representative Smyre, will follow Representative Watson in that order. We placed something on your desk this morning early to give you some history as to why we're here and how we arrived on this day. It is from the Georgia Association of Black Elected Officials resolution adopted last June at our convention in Savannah. During the legislative session of last year, around this time, I believe it was, Mr. Cohn, you came to me and you asked me to co-sponsor a very important bill, which I did. And I went to the chairman of Ruse, Mr. Smyre, and urged Mr. Smyre to put it on so we could pass it last session. As you know, as we get close to sine die, everybody is lined up at the Rules Committee every morning. And I impressed upon Chairman Smyre to bring that bill out because it was a very important measure. Some people did not understand it, but we did pass it. I was happy to join Mr. Cohn in co-sponsoring that legislation last session. I received a call from Ernie Suggs of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution early June of last year. Ernie Suggs has covered me for probably 25 years around the country, and he said, Tyrone, I want you to know that the University of Arizona has done a national study, and this prestigious institution has discovered that several states in America still have old racist Jim Crow laws on their books. I was astounded. I said, Ernie, are you sure that Georgia is one of those? He said, yes, you're in the study. So I thought back to 1981, my first legislative session after getting elected in 1980, because I remember a woman from DeKalb County, a courageous woman whose name was Eleanor Richardson, who served with great distinction in this chamber for many years. She worked through the code, she worked through the Constitution to purge it of any gender bias legislation and any Jim Crow legislation, and we thought we'd gotten it all in 1981. I recall a few years later when we discovered a law that was on the books that was part of that era that forced law enforcement officers to enforce the laws of segregation in order to receive their state retirement pensions or any retirement pension. We took that one off the books. When I received this call, I was astounded. So in June of last year, I went to two lawyers in legislative council, attorney Patsy Turner and attorney David Bundrick. Patsy Turner did most of the work. She gave us all of the credit, but she really did all of the work. And from June until December, we went through the Georgia Code and we found five bills that needed to be repealed. In December of last year, we pre-filed our legislation. We pre-filed House Bill 25, 26, 27, and 28. 28 became House Bill 373 because it is a retirement bill and did not belong in judiciary. So once it went to judiciary, we had to pull it out, rewrite it, and refile it, and it went to retirement. We found one bill after we had discovered the error on 28. That's the one that Representative Cone will carry. It is House Bill 372. So let me briefly tell you what these bills will do once we pass them today. House Bill 25 will repeal an act enacted in 1959 that gave the governor the discretion to close any state college or university that allowed African-American students to enroll in order to preserve the good order of the peace of this state and dignity of this state. That really was designed to avoid desegregation. Any college or school controlled by this state would close down at the order of the governor, 1959. House Bill 26 is an act that repeals the 1956 act. This bill will repeal the law that was designed to allow the governor to suspend compulsory attendance in this public school systems when white parents kept their children out of the public schools that were allowing African-American children to enroll. This gave those school districts cover and a way to maintain segregated schools. They would not be punished under the compulsory attendance law. That's House Bill 26. House Bill 27 is an act that repeals an article allowing students to receive a tuition grant to attend private schools instead of public schools. When the U.S. Supreme Court ordered desegregation of public schools in America, many states resisted for years. And they decided that one way to avoid desegregation would be to support the construction of private segregation academies. The state of Georgia passed this law so that they could send tuition grants to those students and to those schools. And the House Bill 373 will repeal a measure in Title 47 that would allow for school teachers who left the public school system and went to private segregation academies to come back and maintain their service in the public employee retirement system that was designed for public school teachers. These are the measures that we found in our code that we are repealing, and we know that you're going to vote in the affirmative. We're looking for 180 green buttons today to retire Jim Crow, to bury Jim Crow, to allow us to begin to move forward as one state and as one people. And Mr. Speaker, I yield the well, and we will hear from the rest of the lineup on the order. Mr. Cohn, Mr. Keene, Mr. Porter, Mr. Watson, and Mr. Spirey.
I don't see any questions, Representative Brooks. Thank you. Before I recognize the next person, the chair has just been given some information that the gentleman alleged to be the shooter has been captured in Gwinnett County. And the chair understands that our law enforcement officers have taken him in without incident. He surrendered to them and no one else was injured, nor was he injured. And that is a great testament to the lawful nation that we are, and justice will be served in the future. Chair recognizes Representative Cohen to speak on the bills. Representative Cohen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, and all our guests from all over the state of Georgia. Welcome to the Capitol. It's a pleasure to be here and be serving you guys in this capacity. I don't come with any prepared remarks. Just want to say thanks to all those involved last year helping me get the Constitutional Convention call repeals done. We had calls for segregated schools, segregated militaries. There's several calls we got those repealed, and that was not without the help of a lot of people. And Bill Phillips, he's here somewhere. He's a constituent and our citizen advocate. He did enormous amount of research, and I give him the credit for finding those calls about segregation and bringing them to my attention and allow me to put them in the bill. I'll say this, and this, I'll be very brief. I think these laws we're repealing, they belong in a history book and not in a law book. And I'm glad to be a part of taking these off the books. And with that, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to yield the well. And I appreciate you taking the leadership and doing this as in our first session in the majority party. I want to thank you. Thank you.
The gentleman has yielded the well. Chair recognizes Representative Keene for purposes of speaking on the bills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I appreciate so much Representative Brooks and Cohn's comments and their leadership on this issue. Just briefly, I think this is the appropriate day to do this. When we originally talked about repealing laws today, Representative Brooks brought this to our attention. We'll give him great credit for that. But this is the day to do that. This is the day to do that with our families here, our families watching. I don't know that I've been more proud or feel stronger about a vote that I've cast since I've been here than the ones we're going to cast here in a few minutes. Thank you, Representative Brooks, for allowing me to be part of the legislation. Thank you, Representative Cohn. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask for one thing today. I would like to see, when the board is lit up, let's see a unanimous vote to repeal these laws. I'm going to ask you to do that. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I yield the well.
Gentleman has yielded the well. Chair recognizes Representative Porter to speak on the bills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, it's so great to see these young folks here today. So I thought I'd couch my comments today in terms of giving a short history lesson that was began by Representative Brooks. You know, our Constitution says that all men are created equal. That was based in our biblical roots. But in this country, not everyone was always treated equally. But history is what it is. So how can we do what we know we should do and write our own history? Well, for some of these young folks, Mr. Brooks talked about the ones we're repealing, but let me tell you the kinds of laws that were on the books that had been repealed. Here in Georgia, with regards to burial, the officer in charge shall not bury or allow to be buried any colored persons upon ground set apart or used for the burial of white persons. With regards to restaurants, all persons licensed to conduct a restaurant shall serve either white people exclusively or colored people exclusively and shall not sell to the two races within the same room or serve the two races anywhere under the same license. With regards to amateur baseball, it should be unlawful for any amateur white baseball team to play baseball on any vacant lot or baseball diamond within two blocks of a playground devoted to the Negro race. It should be unlawful for any amateur colored baseball team to play baseball in any vacant lot of baseball diamond within two blocks of any playground devoted to the white race. But it wasn't just Georgia, folks. It was throughout the country. In North Carolina, with libraries, that place of learning, the state library is directed to fit up and maintain a separate place for the use of colored people who may come to the library for the purpose of reading books or periodicals. Or Virginia, with regard to theaters, every person operating any public hall, theater, opera house, motion picture show, any place of public entertainment or public assemblage which is attended by both white and colored persons shall separate the right and colored race. And that's one that I remember growing up in Dublin, Georgia, when my friend Jerome would have to go to the balcony at the old Martin Theater, and I'd go downstairs to watch the same movie. But history is what it is. And isn't it great that we can be here today to move on with history and write our own? But you know, there still are people who don't feel like they have the same equality, and some outside today that may feel like that there are certain policies that may cut off children from peach care, or cut funding from schools, or restrict access to government or their opportunity for the Hope Scholarship. History, folks, is what it is, but we have that opportunity to move on and write the history ourselves by the priorities we set here. So I'm privileged on behalf of our side of the aisle to rise and say, let's also vote unanimously to take these laws and put them from the law books where they appropriately belong and into the history books. Thank you.
Chair recognizes Representative Watson for the purpose of speaking on the bill.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity. Let me introduce to you the lady that runs my house, the very special house. That's Cagney Denise Watson, my two-year-old daughter. Y'all give her a hand, too. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, ladies and gentlemen of the House, and our families that are present here today. Let me just say that I'm happy to speak on this bill and ask for unanimous support also for this bill. But let me say that as chairman of the Black Caucus, I would be remiss if I didn't say that although we're burying Jim Crow, let's not resurrect Lazarus. Only Jesus did that. So we need to make sure that we made a promise when we first started, Mr. Speaker, and members of both parties that we'd be civil. And I'd ask for the next 8 to 10 days that we continue to work in a cohesive method to make sure the citizens of Georgia could be proud of what we all do, because at the end, we are all one family. I'm a little remiss also because some of the members of our families are being locked out of the Capitol as I speak. And I think that we need to make a special mention of that. This is all of our Capitol. All of us are taxpayers. All of us have to be governed by the rules and regulations that this august body makes. And I think that we need to be mindful of whose God we really are serving. My birthday is May 17, 1954. May 17, 1954. And I'm very proud of that. For those of you who are historians or lawyers, that's the historic day for desegregation of schools, Brown versus Board of Education. And in my 50 years, if you didn't count, I've been able to watch, to live, and to observe this country as it moves upward, from desegregating our armed forces, to desegregating our schools and communities, even desegregating our churches. And I thank you for this opportunity. We're elated in this time in history, in this place, in this annals of history that will document this historic and magnanimous vote that we're about to take. And I'm pleased that this august body saw fit to do this, Mr. Speaker. I'm reminded that we have come a long way in my 50 years, but we also have a long way to go. Let me thank Representative Mike Cohen. Let me thank Representative Tyrone Brooks, the Speaker, and others that have taken the time to bring this bipartisan environment to this historic day on Family Day. But let's not let this be our only Family Day. Let's be a family on Monday. Let's be a family on Tuesday. When we break on Wednesday, when we come back on Thursday, let's continue to be a family. Just like on Sunday, when we go to church, when we teach Sunday school, when we listen to our pastor. Don't forget, on Monday, you still have to be a Christian. So I ask that we continue to be civil, that we be elated that this is a historic piece of legislation. But remember that we're one Georgia. We're one family, united under God. Thank you so much, speakers, and thank you, this august body.
Chair recognizes Representative Smyre for purposes of speaking on the bills.
Mr. Speaker and ladies and gentlemen of the House, I have followed the gentleman from DeKalb and ask that you would allow the security to accommodate the people that are trying to get in the people's house, the state capitol. This is a great day in Georgia when my longtime friend, Representative Brooks, asked me to speak today. I thought about it long and hard to think about what I would say on a day that we come and pay respect to our families, and I want to thank everyone for being here. I know I have some good friends here from Columbus who I cherish and love, and I've got a chance to meet a lot of y'all's families, and I think that's healthy, and I think that's good. And I want to thank the speaker and all the members of this House and Representative Brooks, who I have known and respected for many years, and thank him for his contribution for providing a lot of us a better quality of life for some of the things that you have done in your career and in your history. And then I want to thank Mike Cohen, who the two of them who got together and to come together as one and to bring us together. And there's old saying, say, we might have come on different ships, but now we're all in the same boat. Thank you. I remember when this came up in the Rules Committee and we passed it out, and I want to thank the Rules Committee Chairman and the committee this year, Representative Earhart, and all the members of the Rules Committee for standing up and bringing this out again. I think this is something that we need a little healing. But the gentleman said it best from the 91st, we ought to make every day a good day and a family day. And we ought to have a lot of tolerance for our differences and our difference of opinions and our difference of ideas. We ought to be tolerant and more tolerant with one another as we all came to represent the people back home. And Mr. Speaker, these laws that we come to take off the books today have been painful over the years for a lot of people. It's been the philosophy of my father, who I love and respect, who used to tell me all the time that education is the escalator to upward mobility. Son, when opportunity knocks, be ready to open the door, because it may never, ever knock again. And one of the most painful memories is that of my father. My grandfather served 26 years in the military in the old 29th Infantry All-Black Army at that time in Fort Benning. He served for 32 years. He was a master sergeant. My father served 26 years in the military. He was a specialist 6 in transportation in the 54th Transportation Division of the United States Army. He got out of the Army, went back to OCS, became a helicopter pilot, flew helicopters. In fact, once I remember flying in Lyndon Johnson when we were stationed out in Fort Sill at the missile base there in Fort Sill, Oklahoma. And he could take a helicopter apart, put it back together, and then fly it. But one of the deepest memories that I can remember as growing up was when he retired, he was denied the right to teach in a flight school. Take a helicopter apart, put it back together, and fly it. He was denied that right because he was black.
And then I went to Fort Valley. I had most of my life, and I've told Tyrone Brooks this story, I was mostly in an integrated society, being in the military. At least we were there together. I don't know how integrated it was, but we were going to school together. And one day I was at Fort Valley, and I had never tasted nor been a part of the civil rights movement, because I went to Germany in 91 and came back, I mean in 61 and came back in 66. I finished high school in Frankfurt, Germany. And I got back and I went to Fort Valley. And Hosea Williams, who served in this body, who has just an impact on my life, because y'all have heard me say this many, many times, if you ever see a turtle sitting on a fence post, you know that he or she didn't get there by themselves. Somebody helped put them there. So regardless of how high we may go in the political arena, people put us where we are. And I met Hosea Williams at a rally in Sandersville, Georgia. He was fighting for, I forgot the cause, but he was a warrior, if there ever was one. And when I got down and afterward, I told Reverend Williams, I said, Reverend Williams, I'm a member of the Student Government Association. I want to get into politics. He said, young man, he said, let me tell you something. He said, always remember this. Say, in politics, it's like a baseball game. But when I was growing up, I couldn't go to baseball games. I had to go to the fence and look at the games through a knot hole. And he said, you know how looking through a knot hole, you go up to a fence and you look at it. And you look in it. And what you see is maybe the second baseman or maybe the third baseman. But it's like politics. If you want to get inside politics, get inside of the ball game. Because when you get inside of the ball games, you find out what the coaches and the managers are doing, and that's who's running the ball game. But never look at politics through a knot hole. If you want to be involved, get inside of the ball game, because the only people in America who set public policy are elected officials. The only people in America. And that story has stuck with me for a long time, that Reverend Williams, who never had the opportunity to do that, he watched it through a knot hole, through baseball games. He watched it through a knot hole. And those of us who are now participating in this process, we owe a lot of gratitude to those people who've passed on, who have not been able to live the life that we're living abundantly here in America. My favorite quotation is one from the late noted educator, Dr. Benjamin E. Mays, who's the president emeritus of Morehouse College, who once stated that, and I quote, "You make your living by what you get. You make your life by what you give. Some folks gave their lives so that we might live abundantly here." So, Mr. Speaker, I'm proudly come today to say that it's long overdue. I'm glad we're doing it. I thanks for the statesmanship of the men and the women that are bringing this resolution forward. And I'd like to see us vote and today take a bold step to put the future behind us. But be ever mindful that we have a tremendous amount of responsibility as we look to the future.
They will be taking a vote soon on 5 Jim Crow era laws that were racially discriminatory. That will not be while we're on the air, but we are assured they will do that, and probably with a unanimous vote in the House of Representatives.
I'm sure. And of course, with the history of these Jim Crow laws and the repeal that will be taking place later today, we wanted to turn to our guest again one more time, Dr. Myrick Harris. I'm wondering if you can just help us sum up what the significance of the repeal is, in that these laws have not been enforced in some time.
Well, yes, it is a symbolic act. But it's a symbolic act that really means that the state has at least decided to recognize, to acknowledge the fact that the laws are on the books, that they should be dispelled, they should be exorcised from the Constitution. And it also holds the state accountable. accountable to make sure that these kinds of laws are not put on
not
the books
back
again.
So I guess we have some future to look forward
yes.
to as well.
Yes,
well, we want to thank you so much for being our guest
thank
on this
you.
Special edition of Lawmakers. Coming up Monday on Lawmakers, it's back to business as usual under the Gold Dome. Legislative Day 32 is sure to be busy as the 40-day deadline looms ever closer. Lawmakers returns here Monday evening at 7 p.m. And just a reminder for those of you with access to the Internet, you can certainly watch Lawmakers online. It's streamed live and then archived on our website every night that we're on the air. If you're a fan of Dr. Wayne Dyer, you'll want to stay tuned for The Power of Intention. That's coming up next on Georgia Public Broadcasting.
And we're going quickly back to the House where they are voting on House Bill 25, the first of the repeals of
The Jim Crow era laws, prohibiting the governor from closing the schools at will. So here comes that historic vote.
All members voted. Chair would like to request unanimous consent. House rules do not allow the speaker to vote. The speaker would like to vote unless there's objection. Is there objection? Chair hears no serious objection, so the chair is going to vote anyway. Because the chair thinks it's appropriate. Have all members now voted? I'm waiting on you. I want to make sure all members have a chance to vote. Have all members now voted? All members now voted. The clerk will lock the machine on the passage.
And, of course, with that historic vote coming in there, unanimous consent of House Bill 25, marking the end of our broadcast.
Join us Monday on Lawmakers. Thank you for watching.